Snoo Math is whipping motherfuckers ass. You wanna know how to rhyme, you better learn how to add. It's mathematics.
Mighty most definitely.
It's simple mathematics. Check it out. I revolve around science.
What are we talking about here?
Peace, peace, peace. Welcome to another episode of Wise the Dome. Today I have a very special guest, man, my brother Okomfo. He's a chef, he's a historian, and we're going to go through some of the history of, you know, food cultivation in pre-colonial Africa, among other things. We got some other topics we're going to build on, but I'm going to let him get the floor. He has a presentation and some slides to go through, so we're going to get it cracking.
Hey, trying to figure this out real quick.
Oh yeah, for sure. Let me pause it real quick. All right, G, the floor is yours.
All right. You want to ask the questions and we can do it like that?
Yeah, let's do it like that.
I got it in order.
All right, bet. All right, so let me pull up. So I know that the first one was. So we were going to build on food cultivation in pre-colonial Africa.
Right. Okay, yeah, this is important because a lot of people get confused by the misconception that we see in media and in modern understanding of Africans. Africa's important mm-hmm. to food cultivation and domestication of animals and plants. Mm. Africans basically started to domesticate plants and animals around 10,000 BP, meaning before the Common Era. Mm. You know what I'm saying? That was a long time ago. Yeah. 10,000 years ago.
Wow. Right.
From the last glacial maximum, that's 20,000 years ago, and close to the Ice Age, the Sahara was a hyper-arid area, more than it is today, actually. And a lot of people don't know that. People think the Sahara was always dry.
Right. It was green at one point, right?
Right. It was green at one point. And when the majority of the rest of the world was going through Ice Age, Africa was going through a wet period, actually.
Okay.
So you had the Atlantic Ocean was creating a lot of moisture, a lot of rain that was blowing over, you know, in the Sahara region and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So the Sahara was a really wet place at one point. And even recently in the Sahara, you had an archaeologist find the remains of a prehistoric whale.
Wow.
In the Sahara.
Wow.
Now, the crazy part about this is that this whale had legs.
What?
It had legs.
Wow. So it's like some real prehistoric type.
Real prehistoric type. You know what I'm saying? And you know what I'm saying? They said over time, you know, the whale must have, this ancestor, I shouldn't call it a whale. Mm-hmm. This ancestor of the whale mm-hmm. end up losing his legs mm. when, you know what I'm saying, when the ice caps begin to melt.
Right, right.
You know what I'm saying? So we have rock art too to show how fertile the Sahara was. Telesi in the Sahara. Mm-hmm. The northern part of Chad, Algeria, you see plenty of rock art of animals that's not associated with deserts.
Mm. Right, so and that's what I was going to ask you. So, like, with like how you were saying that, you know, part of Africa was going through a wet period while other places were going through, you know, different ice ages, that would add to the like biodiversity of the region, right?
Right. It really did. And you also had an oscillating wet and dry periods. Mm. This is during the early Holocene period, mm-hmm. where like in Nephthah Playa, water, like big bodies of water start to form, and it would dry out sometime.
Mm-hmm.
But when the water was there, it attracted a lot of animals and humans.
Mm, right.
You know what I'm saying? So this is, huh?
No, but that's interesting though, like because. Like, you know, even in the first thing you said about was is how like Africa, pre-colonial Africa, doesn't get the credit that it deserves as far as plant and animal domestication. And it's just ill to think that this place full of biodiversity, while these other places are going through ice ages, which may have killed off a lot of the biodiversity that it once had, but Africa is still looked at as, you know, Africans are still looked at as, you know, not having the ability or understanding to be able to, you know, use these plants and animals for the different things that they use them for.
Right. You know, and so also too, during this ice age, most of North America was under the ice.
Right.
All the way down from Canada all the way down to the Mason-Dixon line was covered in ice.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? You get your, the Great Lakes were created when the ice began to melt.
Mm. Wow.
So I'm going to bring it up later, mm-hmm. but just to throw in a zinger, the Western Hemisphere had no sheep, they had no goats, or no longhorn cattle until Africans came.
Wow. Yeah, we definitely gonna have to hit. Yeah, we definitely got to build on that.
Right. They had a prehistoric horse,
uh-huh.
but it died off during the Ice Age.
Mm.
And the horse was reintroduced to North America when Africans came.
Right. Wow. And see, that just kind of goes to what I was just asking you about is that biodiversity and the climate that Africans were in led to obviously, you know, being able to cultivate these different plants and domesticate these different animals when, as you said, North America, half of it was under ice. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Also too, we got to understand that when it comes to animal and plant domestication, we kind of got to pull back the camera a little bit.
Okay.
We're too close to the horse.
Right.
Prior to humans domesticating plants and animals, they foraged for them in the wild.
Mm.
And most scientists believe that the domestication of plants and animals was actually a kind of like a human cautionary method.
Right.
And a response to a global shift in the climate.
Mm, really?
Yeah. So when that happened, you know, before that period happened, ancient humans, Africans and other humans around the world, they will go out into the wild and forage for food.
Right.
I mean, it grew, you know what I'm saying? It grew in bushes and, you know, it grew naturally. It wasn't no grids or gardens. They mm-hmm. just go out and forage.
Right.
But over time, they saw a decrease in the yield of the things they were gathering. And when this began to happen and happen more frequently, they panicked. And when they panicked, they started to domesticate certain crops
mm.
and put them into like agricultural grids or gardens
mm.
and farming instead of foraging them in the wild. They still foraged them in the wild.
Mm-hmm.
But as a cautionary measure, they started agriculture.
And so it was pretty much kind of born out of necessity.
Right.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think pre-colonial Africa gets the credit that, you know, for its agricultural its
prowess?
Yeah.
it should, but unfortunately we don't.
Yeah.
And one of the dope things about Africans is we didn't have a model of people before us
right.
to go off of. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
We didn't have a civilization or a society we can look back and say, oh, That's how they do it.
Right.
Let's do it that way, or let's improve on the way they did it.
Right.
Everything our ancestors did, they had to go through a period of trial and error.
Mm.
That means probably eating stuff that probably wasn't good for you.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And you had to write it. You know what I'm saying? You had to make note of it. Like, yeah, we can't eat that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And other things that they ate and they noticed, you know what I'm saying? When I eat this, I get more energy. When I eat this, you know what I'm saying? I feel this way.
Right.
It's kind of how the whole coffee thing in Ethiopia came about.
How did that come about?
Okay, the coffee, if I can remember correctly, the coffee thing in Ethiopia came about by a guy. He was a herder, and he would herd his cattle. And when they get in a certain area, they eat something, and they started to go buck wild.
Mm.
And he couldn't figure it out, but he couldn't figure out at first, like, man, what are they eating? Like,
right.
They going buck wild. So he figured out they was eating these coffee beans. Mm. So he took them back, and I believe he was like a priest or something too.
Mm-hmm.
He took them back, and he tried different methods. That's an African mind. Now, when you get something new, you got to investigate it. You know what I'm saying? He didn't just eat it right away. He tried different methods on it first.
Right.
And one of the methods that he tried was steeping it in hot water. And he drank it. Hmm. And then all of a sudden, he got a whole bunch of energy.
Wow.
And you know what I'm saying? And from that, you know what I'm saying? And from that, and that's another thing too. Africans watch what animals ate.
Mm. And see how they reacted to it. Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's deep, man.
That's kind of how scientists do today when they be testing certain things on animals first.
Right.
Before before we get it. That's an African thing.
Wow.
Yeah. But yeah, that's how coffee came about. But I kind of got off of track, but the animal domestication and early humans creating agriculture as a safety precaution to, you know what I'm saying, to stave off starvation.
Right.
Now, Africa, too, Africa don't get the credit for our crops in terms of a lot of them are drought resistant.
Mm. Can you explain what, for those that may not know, what does it mean for a crop to be drought resistant?
Meaning that they don't require much water and or much human intervention altogether.
Right.
They grow faster. It's a higher yield on the crops.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, people be able to eat during a period while other crops are in a drought, these crops flourish.
Mm.
Like sorghum, cow peas, what black people call black-eyed peas.
Mm-hmm.
That's that's the Afro-Atlantic black-eyed pea. Even though cow peas has a large variety, it's a large genus of cow peas. We only know the black eyed peas, but it's all different types and colors from white to purple.
Wow.
Black eyed peas.
Yeah, that's deep. Just for them to be able to, like you said, to be able to observe that and then use that to advantage and to be able to, like you said, domesticate that when times where other things weren't growing that well, that just goes to show the, you know, ingenuity of our people and we are the originators, man. You know,
right. I got that from Dr. Clark too. How he broke it down. Like we didn't have a template to go off of.
Right,
and that kind of goes into technology too. As far as like manufacturing tools, in the same time period, you have a stone age, iron age, etc. But people don't know that those are named after the technology,
right,
of the period,
right.
And you know, if you were a person living during the convergence of from stone to iron. You know what I'm saying? You was in metals, you were in a tough place.
Right.
Because, you know, a person sitting there, we don't think about it today because we have everything readily available. But a person sitting there today, sitting there in ancient times, trying to forge an arrow.
Yeah, that's tough. You know what
I'm saying? It's some hard. It's hard. I don't know if anybody ever tried to make an arrow out of stone. It's hard.
Right.
You're gonna break it. It's gonna chip. It's gonna break. You know what I'm saying? And next thing you know, you're gonna have a pile of broken arrowheads.
Right. Right.
Meaning that the more time you spend doing that, you're not gonna eat.
Yeah. Facts.
That's why a lot of when archaeologists be digging up these arrowheads, they be finding them in piles.
Yes.
And they'd be like, oh, it must have been an arrowhead manufacturing site. No, it was probably one person sitting there
for
hours trying to make one perfect one to go hunt. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
But then when that transition hit from stone and iron and other metals, you know what I'm saying? You had to make it one time.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Good.
And then you got the technology to start casting the metals to where you can make, you know what I'm saying, hundreds at one time.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? But then it was also people who were still using the stone.
Right.
And then people became obsolete.
Mm, because they had a harder time
adjusting to it and,
mm-hmm.
you know what I'm saying, and understanding it. But the picture I have of right now, it's a rock art scene from northeastern Chad. You can see it's pastoral rock art. You can see the cattle, the longhorn, and stuff like that. Remember I said that the Western world, including North America, had no cattle.
Wow.
So when they talk about Texas Longhorn, that's mythology. The Texas Longhorn genetic parents is an African Longhorn.
Wow.
That we see here in this painting right here.
Yep. You can clearly see
it. Yeah. And it was the Africans that they brought over here who mastered a husbandry of these longhorns for thousands of years. And never got the credit for it. They call it the Texas longhorn.
You know, and that's crazy because, you know, man, I lived in Texas for almost 20, 30 years. And, you know, they love the symbolism of the Texas longhorn, right? But you never hear about this part of the history, ever.
Yeah. To be scholastically honest, it has two parents.
Mm-hmm.
One is the African longhorn, and the other one is a cattle or bovine from Portugal and Spain.
Okay.
And now, what most scholars believe is that this Texas longhorn is a child of those two.
Okay.
And those two were brought here during the early Spanish expeditions to the New World.
Okay.
But with them came Africans, and we already know that.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
So when they got there, they got them here, and they started to breed them together, and out of that, you get a Texas Longhorn.
Wow. That's some cold history, man. It is.
When I figured that out, I'm like, wow.
Yeah, because like just to see how they, I mean, that symbolism is heavy. Like, especially in Texas, man, and you just never, and you know, a lot of times we'll take these things on face value, and you know, I mean, the way they treat it, it sounds like it's indigenous to Texas. You know what I'm saying? Like,
right? They're so proud of it, they don't even know the origins of anything.
Right.
That's the problem, you know. What the good book say? Probably comes before a fall.
Yes, sir.
And also too, in the Southwest, the open air grazing and cattle ranching, all those techniques and know-how is an African import.
Mm, really?
Europeans didn't have open air grazing in Europe.
Right.
They didn't really have no big animals like that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So they didn't know what to do with these things. Neither did Native Americans like that.
Right. And so it was African genius that showed them how to do it.
Right. The cattle ranchers, open air grazing and all that. And this is not me talking. You can look it up.
Yeah, because there's a, like, I've got a few books on it. I got to find them. But there's several groups in Africa that still make their, like, their livelihood is their cattle.
That's true.
Yeah,
The Fulani. The Fulani was an... They, I have I have the record of them explicitly saying that they targeted the Fulani for their expertise in cattle herding.
Wow.
And brought them here.
Wow.
So we can squash anything that comes that way because no person is going to risk life and limb going on a floating tomb and going to a whole other continent and get somebody to do something that they can do themselves.
Right.
Nobody.
Right.
If you can do it yourself, you wouldn't even take the risk of even going, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
It's like now, let's say it's a life on another planet that can do something that we can't do, or a life on another planet that can do something. We're going to take a spaceship, risk all this money, all this life, to go mess with these, to go to this other planet, and we can do it ourselves. They're not
going to do that. It's not going to happen.
Right. They couldn't do it, so they had to go get experts on doing it.
Wow.
Boy. And when you don't want to pay somebody for their services and expertise, you enslave them.
Yeah. Facts. And it's crazy because these are the same people that they said were subhuman and didn't have any civilization and didn't have any skills when we were the ones that had all the skills. Mm-hmm. As far as the European is concerned.
Right, and we also got to understand, too, that mentality, that thinking, that ideology of subhuman, don't know anything, no civilization, that's a really, really, really late philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
The ancient Europeans didn't think that way.
Right.
This is 1800s, maybe late 1700s, you see the emergence of this anti-African, or what they call... African phobia, mm-hmm, amongst them, because it didn't exist before.
Mm. You think
Homer and the Odyssey and the Iliads, they praise Africa.
Yep, most definitely.
They tell you that's where they came. That's the gods came from Ethiopia.
Right.
That's what the Homer and the Odysseys and Iliads say.
Right.
The sciences and all that stuff, that's where they get credited. Modern people accredit the Greeks for science and medicine and stuff like that, but the Greeks accredit the Africans for it.
Right. Right. That's deep.
But yeah, this cave painting is a prime example. It's a primary source. You can see him getting it in right there.
Yep.
And the next one is it's African women harvesting grains in the Sahara.
Mm. Wow.
Second millennium BCE.
Wow.
You see the afro? I see an afro right there.
Yep.
It sits at the top of the bun.
That's amazing, God, because like you said, I think it's a powerful point. They didn't have a template. That makes it even, you know, because we are the template. They were the template.
Right.
You know what I mean? And to use your own genius to be able to figure these things out, man, just to, you know, like, I don't think people realize and understand how much, like, see, that's science, right? Because they're going to have, because you have to.
Scientific method.
Yeah. I mean, and so I don't know. It's just a beautiful thing to see, but go ahead.
Yeah, it's a scientific method. But now we go from, you know, saying prehistoric Africa,
mm-hmm,
up into the modern period. Even before we go there, we had to also take into account that for 4,000 years before the Common Era, African crops are already traveling the world, crossing the Indian Ocean, you know what I'm saying, going into, mm-hmm, India, parts of Asia, it was already happening. That's 4,000 years before our Common Era, our, right, Common Period.
And does, right, and how, and what was that trade? Was that migration? Like what, through the?
It was both trade and migration.
Mm-hmm.
I'm reading a book right now, and it's talking about the early African presence in Asia.
Mm.
And this from, I think it's from Cambridge University or,
mm-hmm,
or Harvard. I forget which one, but they were saying how it's a lot of Chinese quote unquote folklore that have these Africans in it.
Oh.
Who like inhabited a mountainous region They came there on boats and they inhabited this mountainous region. I forget the name, but I sent all that stuff to you. That's something else we can build about.
But
they said that the Chinese people attacked these Africans in the mountains. One of the first Chinese emperors or kings or whatever attacked these Africans in the mountains who they knew and who they were already doing trade and stuff with.
Mm-hmm.
And the Africans killed them.
Oh, wow.
And out of this came a myth.
Mm-hmm.
Out of this became a myth. And if you watch the Marvel movie, the Iron Fist movie.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Remember that place they went to? You see the movie?
Yep.
Remember that place that he was from?
Like that, like, you mean like that forest? Was that?
Yeah. Remember that thing that was in the mountain?
Yeah.
That dark thing that they were trying to keep coming out the mountain?
Right.
That's what that was about.
Wow. Oh, wow.
If you saw the movie, you know what I'm talking about.
Right. Wow. So
the dark force that was in that mountain, they were trying to keep it in there. He ended up letting it out.
Yeah. That was symbolic of the Africans that were there.
Yes.
Wow.
And that region is it's an actual region in real life though. Mm-hmm. And they end up naming it after these Africans that inhabited that region.
Wow, yeah, we definitely got to build on that.
Yeah, it's crazy, bro. It's crazy. And all the little figurines they make for this myth, this folklore, because it's not really a myth, it's a folklore the details are obscure through time, but there's a record of this actually happening.
Right. And so they made figurines of these Africans as well?
Yes. Yeah.
Right.
But no, I digress a little bit.
Yeah, for sure.
Coming forward, like I said, 4,000 years before our common era, African foods were already growing across the Indian Ocean into Asia, India, and other parts of the world already. But the modern one is what they call the Columbian Exchange or the Triangle Trade.
Mm, right.
This is when our ancestors come into play, and they were part of those commodities that were being traded.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, without argument, the most valuable of all the commodities combined was our ancestors that were brought here.
Right.
But they bought yams and groundnuts, okra, rice, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
It's a site where you can Google Earth and you can see the rice fields from space that our ancestors created in South Carolina.
Wow. I got a book called Black Rice that African Origins of Rice Cultivation in America.
By Judith Kearney, right?
Yep.
Yeah, I got that book too. I use a lot of her work, man. She cold with it.
Yeah, she cold, man.
I like primaries. I'm a primary person.
Me too.
She be going in.
I have to. It's been a while since I read it. I got to read it again. I got that. I bought the High on the Hog book too. That was off of that that Netflix documentary.
Yeah, and the book was out before the documentary. The book is kind of old.
Yep.
Yeah, that's a good book too. Judith Kearney has another book called In the Shadows.
Okay.
A lot of what I'm quoting from this slide is from that book.
Okay. I'm definitely going to cop then. What is it called again?
In the Shadows.
Okay.
It's a lot of good books out there, man. I can't even.
It's funny, like, not to, and I'll let you get back to it in just a second, but it's funny, like, you know, like whenever we have these conversations online and we see a lot of people that like to deny the African origins of things, and there's so much evidence that proves them. You know what I mean?
What? that's what it do. Hey, that's how I always get them. They, well, I'm not this, I'm not that, I ain't from Africa. Okay, stop. What's in your refrigerator?
Right.
Stop right now. Go to your refrigerator. Open it up.
Right.
You a Hebrew? Okay, I want to see some gefilte fish. I want to see some matzo balls.
Right.
I want to see, you know what I'm saying? Something that's indicative of you saying who you are, where you are.
Yep.
I don't care what you're talking about. Like, I had a debate with a Hebrew Israelite one time, and I was on his blog talk radio show.
Mm-hmm.
And he was in, it was in the process of having a Passover, whatever. Mm-hmm. And like in between us debating, he doing like a, what's in that? He doing like a commercial for like people to come to the Passover, whatever. Mm-hmm. He's saying they'll have performances, stuff like that, mm-hmm. and the food, right? He had a whole list of food, collard greens, pickle beans, black eyed peas. You know what I'm saying? Go on and on. So I got, when the show got back from commercial, I said, listen, now I'm about to get you. Show me a black eyed pea in Israel.
Back.
You can't do it, can you? Show me a collard green. You can't do it, can you? Mm. This is who you are. Whether you don't, whether you like it, understand it or not, it's who you are.
Right.
I go to your ground. Let me sweep your foot.
Oh man, they're gonna spit on that broom.
Well, yeah, jump out. You yeah, jump out the building.
Yeah. They're gonna spit on what that broom.
What are you doing, Aiden? Mama didn't tell you to get that. Put it back.
Where's the other one?
Yeah, go in there. I'm doing something. Come on. Go this way. No, put it back. Go that way. Okay, yeah, take that one. Okay, yeah, that one. That's it. Okay. Yeah, but no, bro. They,
yeah, that's funny, they, though. Yeah. That's funny. Because it's like, I mean, you're right. I mean, they're saying one thing, but the proof is in the pudding, man.
Right, chicken. Right. About chicken and watermelon. Chicken, right. They had chicken, watermelon. Hey, chicken and watermelon is some ancient African stuff.
Right.
But if we like it, understand it or know it or not, I'm going to show that later on, but you can go ahead, bro. All
right.
But yeah, over 24 food crops were introduced to the new so-called New World by our enslaved ancestors. Mm. And an interesting fact, even in, as far as Barbados, they brought camels.
Wow.
To Barbados.
Wow.
Wow. In Judith Carney's book, she has a illustration somebody drew in the 1700s of an African in Barbados on the camel.
Wow. Wow. Wow.
Like, there's no debate whether it's the Barbados or not, because it's a map of Barbados, yeah, different like geological features, and one of them is an African on the camel.
And man, see, and
not a camel from Arabia, but right, it's African camel,
a distinctly African camel.
Yeah, they got different humps,
right?
They got different colors, and they got different amounts of hair.
Mm.
The Arabian camels are more hairy.
And what do you think that says? Like the fact that they were able to find that.
Who?
Or just what do you think that says, or what do you think that means to for Africans to even have camels that are, I mean, I guess that just shows and proves, obviously, for those who still don't have an understanding of where we came from, the things that we brought over here, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they brought the camel on the quote unquote slave ships.
Mm.
Wow. They brought a lot of live animals, a lot of live African animals over here on the slave ships for food provisions.
Mm.
You couldn't, you know, there was no refrigeration, so they had to, you know, either salt and some kind of other methods of preserving mm-hmm. the food, but other animals were live.
Mm.
And they were kept in cages mm-hmm. that hung off the edge of the slave ship.
Wow, really?
Like, you know what I'm saying, fowls, pigs, mm-hmm. chickens. Some of them were of European origins, and other words were African mm-hmm. animals, like the woolless sheep that they brought here.
Yeah.
That's prevalent like in Jamaica and in the Caribbean and in Latin America.
Wow. Yeah, man.
Here's a picture right here. This is a wow. spaceship.
Mm-hmm.
The last ship.
So I see the cages on the outside of the last ship. Is that where the animals?
I'm gonna zoom in. This is where the animals would be right here. These are animals in there in wow. the description.
Wow.
So yeah, they're bringing African animals over here too. The guinea fowl, what we call chicken today.
Right.
Our ancestors didn't eat the boiler. That's what the industrial name mm-hmm. for the industrial chicken. It's the boiler.
Okay.
Our ancestors ate guinea fowl.
Mm. What is
and
that?
They kept
Is that like, is that bigger, or is it like, what's different about it?
It's not necessarily bigger. They have it's a different flavor to it. And they have the guinea fowls have speckles and spots on them.
Okay.
And the guinea fowls come in different varieties too. And the fowl in general, this specific fowl is found all over Africa, all the way to East Africa. And we ate it. It's Egyptian hieroglyphic proof that they eat it in Egypt.
Wow.
Yes, it is. You can make fun of us, put paint on our face, and red lips with chicken and watermelon if you want to. You know what I'm saying? You can't deny it's delicious.
Right. And
you
like,
know what I'm saying? So what?
And but they like, that's the crazy is like how they made, and I know we would get into that later, but how they made that trope something that is supposed to be derogatory towards us, but they eat it just as much as anybody.
Hell yeah. And they have been for thousands of years, like anybody. They had fowl in Rome. They got coins. Y'all got coins in Rome with chickens on it. So why are we getting that?
I got a 12-piece on the coins. Wow. But yeah, I didn't know. I mean, I always wondered how they brought certain animals here, but now I get to see a diagram of it. I mean, and so like on the ones on the two on the left, what are we looking at there?
I'm not sure what kind of animal is in there, but I think from the description it said it was sheep.
Okay.
The hairless, the woolless African sheep. Because again, North America had no cattle.
Right.
They had no cattle here. The herd or anything of that nature. There's all African ingenuity. Even when it comes down to the planting of crops, Africans used a method to where they planted certain crops together.
Mm-hmm.
Or they would plant okra and rice together.
What would be the reason they did that?
The okra caused the rice to have a higher yield.
Wow.
When being planted in the same vicinity.
Wow.
It altered the chemical components of the soil to a point to where it, you know what I'm saying, it made the rice grow faster.
Once again, the scientific mind of our people.
Yeah. And they didn't know, they didn't understand that first either. They thought they were trying to hide food and all this other crazy shit.
Mm-hmm.
Until some smart European came and said, whoa, wait. You know, they're doing this to increase the yield.
Right.
Because they basically put it on autopilot. So, you know, because they had to plant it and cultivate it themselves anyway. And, you know what I'm saying? And much of any kind of punishment they would have got would have been the result of a low yield.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know what I'm saying? It was kind of a measure to say, hey, we gonna do this our way.
Right.
The Europeans had no clue about how to cultivate rice. Neither the Native Americans, because there was no rice here. We brought it here.
Right. And, you know.
But they have wild rice here, which is totally different. If you ever ate wild rice, it's chewier.
Yeah.
It got a more grainier, texture to it. You know what I'm saying? I hear a lot of so-called Black Aboriginal people say, well, there wasn't no corn in Africa. Y'all didn't have no meat. Y'all didn't have no maize in Africa.
Yeah.
Wrong. We had sorghum, which they call guinea corn. You can pop it. You can pop it like popcorn and ground it up like corn husk and corn kernels and all that other stuff.
I remember so, they used to say that heavy too. They ain't no corn in Africa. I remember that argument. Mm-hmm. I remember they would talk about corn being in the Bible and all that kind of stuff too.
Well, I mean, corn is a very generic word.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to talk about some science. Corn is like more of a culinary, you know, word, and it derives from kernel.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So it has no real agricultural scientific bearing if we're talking about the origins of something.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Because if that's the case, there's corn everywhere. Of course, it's corn in the Bible. We're going to call it corn.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Right. It's grains and mullets and all type of stuff all over the world.
Right.
Cereals and stuff like that. And unfortunately, a lot of them migrated out of Africa with the people who migrated out of Africa to those regions. But that's a whole nother story.
Whole nother story, right?
Yeah.
The African origins of Coca-Cola.
Ooh wee. That's a beautiful thing too. Coca-Cola is a quintessential example of the marriage between Africans and indigenous people here in America. Because coca is an indigenous, or cacao is an indigenous seed mm-hmm. from this hemisphere.
Mm-hmm.
And cola, the cola nut, is an African seed.
Well, you know what? I can't even front. Like, I never put two and two together, Coca-Cola. I never put that together, but go ahead.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of people don't. Hey, it's a lot of things.
It's like right in front of your face. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Yeah.
Palm olive. Remember palm olive growing up? Mm-hmm. Palm olive dish soap. Regular body soap, palm olive.
Yep.
That's an African product.
Mm. Like
the Brit, I think it was the British. Yeah, the British, they tried to Europeanize it, and they had a whole story behind the Greeks used to take baths. No. It's the West African palm oil that y'all got.
That's all I was going to say.
From y'all colonies in West Africa.
Wow.
Palm oil.
Wow. Right under your nose.
That's free trade. That's a free trade area for you.
Right.
Where they come in and they promote their stuff over your stuff and say, you know, it's a free trade area.
Right. And I'm looking at the slide, and so we bought the cola nuts on the slave ship, huh?
Yes. On the slave ships, well they got it as a provision.
Okay.
The ship captains bought it as a provision because they paid attention to what Africans were doing.
Mm-hmm.
They ate it for energy, but they were also putting it in water to alter the taste.
Mm.
And when the water was kept in casks on slave, the metal and wood casks on slave ships, it became stagnant real quick. Mm-hmm. But that goes into, again, how little they knew about preserving water.
Right.
Because no knowledgeable person would put water to storage in wood or metal.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's not going to work. But they didn't know any better.
Hmm.
Africans knew better.
Right.
They put the cola nut in the water, in the stagnant water, to make it more palatable, more drinkable.
Hmm.
Yeah. And mm-hmm. same thing with, we got in Latin America, you got agua fresca, right?
Mm-hmm.
The tamarind seed, they put tamarind, because tamarind is an African fruit.
Mm-hmm.
There's no debate about that.
Right.
But tamarind is really popular in Mexico.
Wow.
It's one of their national drinks.
Really? And is that from Maroons that are enslaved Africans that were in Mexico?
Yeah.
Mm.
Right on the money. Tamarind is one. It's a tamarind agua fresca, and they have a Jamaica agua fresca, which is made with hibiscus, which is another African substance that we brought over here.
Mm.
And we know African Americans, we drink red drink when?
Right.
In the Caribbean, they drink red drink when? Right. What are we debating about? You never had Kool-Aid?
Right.
What's Kool-Aid? Agua fresca in powder form. You put some water on it.
Wow.
We did that. They put the
And so they was damn near doing that on the ships.
Yeah, they put the fruit in the water to stave off the stagnation.
And what I hope people understand is just the irony of us being the ones that are considered subhuman, no civilization, not, you know, brutes that can't think. And we are the ones that are showing them how to, you know, do these different things that improve the quality of their own lives. But it's us that are the brutes. You know what I mean? Like, it's the irony in that. And just even seeing like being on the ship, and which was probably some of the worst conditions known to man, right? And bringing not just, and so like you in the slides, you've shown the things that we brought with us from the plants, animals, and seeds. But as you mentioned before, like it was us that was the most valuable, because right. without us, they wouldn't know what to do with any of it.
Right. Even going outside of food, you know, Africa has guilds of mm-hmm. certain craftsmanship.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have men who come from a line of men who only were metallurgists, you know, deal with metallurgy mm-hmm. for thousands of years.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Where you get to a point where you can produce a 6-year-old, they can forge something out of, you know what I'm saying, out of iron. That was probably mind blowing for them to see a little kid.
Right.
Doing
right.
this. Right. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
They, you know what I'm saying? The architecture of the Djinné, the great monster, the Djinné.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? It was a seasonal thing, a tradition where everybody in that area had to get together and work on the renovation of it.
Mm.
So you had kids.
Wow.
Some of our ancestors who were kids worked on the great Mossi, the Djinné.
Wow.
Kids. Wow. Kids doing this. You know what I'm saying? Kids making this.
Right.
It's unfathomable to them.
Right.
You know, in Africa, we're the ultimate polyglots.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? We do. We see that today. You can see that today in entertainment. Chris Brown, draw, music,
right,
act, all type of stuff.
Right.
Childish Gambino,
right.
Movies, right. Act, music, scene. Jamie Foxx. We can go on. We get most of our stars are polyglots, even including the crazy ones.
Right.
Yeah, we all have to say that. You know what we're talking about.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, but that's part of being a polyglot and a genius too. You know what I'm saying? You gotta learn how to reel in the crazy.
Yeah, right.
Because you're always on the line between genius and being completely out of your mind.
Right.
And if you're not a stable person, you know what I'm saying?
you're gonna
fall on the other side of the line majority of the time.
Right. Especially in this environment.
Right. Especially when you pursuing things, you know what I'm saying, that comes with
I got you.
You go crazy.
Yep.
Especially you don't read books.
Right. That's the problem.
I can't even look at if a person looked at me in my face and said they didn't read books, I'm gonna have to point them into the opposite direction from me.
Right.
Okay, how much money you got or none of that. They don't mean nothing.
Nope, because your thoughts are not informed. That whole free thinking thing is one thing, but it has to be informed, man. You have to be informed, or
right. Your skepticism has to be informed.
Yes, right.
You can't be a dumb skeptic.
Right.
If you don't know anything, what do you? You know what I'm saying? What's your basis?
What are you basing your skepticism off of?
Right. You're skeptic for skepticism's sake to argue. What are you? what are you talking about?
Right.
That's how when I try to have, if I have a debate or discourse with somebody, that's what we get to the root of.
Yeah.
What's giving you authority to speak on something? Whatever we're talking about right now. What gives you the authority or even an inkling in your mind to think that you're able to have an opinion on it? An opinion that other people should listen to.
Right.
You can't. You can't. I have debates on Facebook all the time about slave food and this slave food. Slave food. I'm like, okay, what gives you the right? What gives you the intellectual fortitude to say anything?
Right. Don't have.
You can't.
Ain't studied a lick of what they're talking
about. Ain't studied a lick. I can get where Oprah come from.
Right.
Hell, Oprah. What's the You can't. What are we talking about? Who are you talking? Who are you talking to?
Right.
People. Well, you. What gives you? I'm a chef. I have been so for 25 years of my life, and yeah. I know my own culture. I know what I eat.
Right.
I know my own culture food.
Right. Right.
Point blank. And period. Not cook other cultures' food as well.
Right. I want to ask you something about that before we go forward. As far as like food and cooking and eating, you know, like how like a lot of Black families like back in the day and still some now would have like, you know, family dinners on Sunday, you know, or like is what like is that African in nature, the way we approach eating food and the way we approach the communal aspect of food?
So you said the key word, the communal aspect.
Right.
In most ancient places, food was weaponized.
Mm. Mm.
You know what I'm saying?
It was more scarce, huh?
It was more scarce, and it was still weaponized, though.
Mm-hmm.
They had a weird, you know what I'm saying? They had a weird attitude around food.
Right.
They had a lot of scarce. Yeah, like you said, scarce, very scarce.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? We don't appreciate how diverse Africa is when it comes to food stuff.
Right.
The majority of the world's leafy greens are in Africa.
Mm. Mm.
They include your collard greens and your in Africa. That's when the European explorers were going in Africa, not the ones that were stealing people, but the ones that were there to steal information.
Mm-hmm.
Looking at what Africa were eating, what they were doing, and say, man, they ate a lot of green, like green plants. Mm. They put it almost in everything. These are for medicine. They add it to stocks and stews, and that's what we do. You throw greens and throw a ham hock in there.
Right. Now, is that a watermelon?
That's one of the African things you can do is put a pot of water on the stove with some greens and throw a ham hock. Not necessarily even to eat the ham hock, but flavoring.
Right.
That's one of the African things you can do.
I'm picking up this slide right here, G. Like, is that a watermelon in ancient Egypt?
Yes, that's the watermelon.
Oh, wow.
It's the ancestor to our current watermelon.
Right. It's literally no mistaking. Like, you can't mistake that for anything else, right?
No, it's about three or four other wall reliefs and tombs where you see watermelons in it.
Wow.
And this is a Cordofanian watermelon, which comes out of Central Africa,
right,
and it's the same watermelon that the Nigerians use in the Egasi.
Mm.
It's yellow in the middle when you open it up.
Really, and it's still used to this day.
Yeah, it's still used to today. Mm. Yeah. That's why our watermelon comes. That's why we love it so much.
Right.
You can laugh at me all you want to. If I know Tutankhamun ate watermelon.
Yeah.
And chicken.
Right.
Chicken. Let me tell you, what's that? A chicken on a limestone fragment found by Howard Carter in front of Tutankhamun's tomb.
Wow. Guinea fowl.
Guinea fowl. Well, that's a guinea fowl right there. The color.
Okay.
West Africa. It's one of the oldest birds, fowl. One of the earliest ones that we domesticated too.
Mm-hmm. And this is what we ate, like compared to like the chicken that we eat now.
The free range chicken, the boiler. This is what we were eating. The Europeans had their chicken there too, but we had our chicken in our own little plot of land around our living quarters.
Wow.
There's another misconception that people think that you know, and it comes from the Nation of Islam and other what I call ethno-religious groups that came about pushing a doctrine that include the changing of your dietary intake. Right. You know, the slave master, he gave you chitlins and he gave you pork, he gave you this stuff, and he didn't give you shit. The enslavers only gave Africans pigs and other animals on occasions, like New Year's, Christmas, stuff like that. And the rest of the year, nigga, you was on your own.
Wow.
You was foraging and hunting on your own. You was eating squirrels and
Wait. Say that again, G. I need people to understand this. Because that's not the narrative. You know what I mean? The narrative is.
Hello?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you can repeat that, because I think that's extremely important as far as what the life of the enslaved African was like.
Right, okay. Our ancestors were not just sitting around indulging in pigs and stuff, the slave master's scraps or whatever you want to call it, as the slave master gave them. It was a very rare occasion they would get a pig or something from the slave master. Mm. Only on holidays, Christmas, New Year's, a baby being born or something like that, you might slide you a pig, right? Now, when you tell us, well, they gave us scraps. We ate scraps. Black people gave us scraps. We had to take scraps. And Jay-Z had a bar, one of his songs. He said, they gave us scraps and pigs intestines.
We made soul food or something, right?
Right. Listen. When they say another one man's trash is another man's treasure, and Africans and other indigenous people, there's no such thing as a scrap.
Right.
We didn't waste nothing.
Right.
Like my grandfather said, we eat it from the rooter
to the tootle. And we see a lot of that today still.
Yeah.
Yeah.
From the rooter to the tootle.
And so, and like everyday life, I want to highlight this point that you
made.
You
know what I'm saying? We had a certain restraint and respect for nature.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? It'll be sacrilegious to waste, to take an animal's life.
Right.
And then waste it.
Right. Right. Right.
That's why we have a problem. The problem we have today, global warming. And one of the biggest problems of global warming is cows. It's too many cows.
Right. Right.
And most of it is wasted.
Right. Right. Damn, that's deep. And you know, just to think about how you said those are special occasions where they may have gotten what we consider scraps. Like you said, that wasn't even a thing to the African or indigenous person, but the fact that a lot of our ancestors had to fend for themselves, like...
Yeah, we foraged. They foraged. They fished, hunted, trapped. It was trapping, you know what I'm saying, squirrels and whatever. Hey, whatever that trap caught,
was got being cooked, right.
Rabbits, you know what I'm saying? Turtles, snails. Most of the time, that's how they got their food.
Right.
But it created a nutrition deficiency in a lot of enslaved people, like rickets and stuff like that, when they weren't getting the proper nutrients and iron deficiencies, which caused them to look for alternative sources of iron, like eating the soil.
Right.
Which they still do in Haiti. They make mud cakes
in
little discs, and they eat them. It's no matter how much money you got or money you don't got, it's part of their tradition.
Right. And it's, and you know, it's interesting that, you know, outsiders may look down on that, but they don't understand the origin.
Why they do it. Right. I'm telling people all the time, like, y'all, listen, you go to McDonald's and probably eat some more grotesque things every you don't even know it. You don't even care.
Right.
Because it's in the shape of a circle. It's more common to your psyche.
Right.
It's a circle.
Or just the colors of the restaurant itself. You know what I'm saying?
Oh yeah, the green. I mean, like green, but the red and the yellow.
Yeah,
it correlates to inclining you to be hungry or feeling hungry.
Mm-hmm.
They got different niggas too, but that's a whole other
stuff. Right.
Yeah. Hey, like I said, we can go there.
Oh yeah, I'm with it.
But yeah, that's another thing too. African food crops and food stuff also gained the derogatory connotations that we gained.
Mm.
And, you know, all these agriculturists and stuff like that were deeming African crops to be not suitable for human consumption, but only for animal fodder and to animal feed.
Wow.
When in actuality, these were super, what they call now super foods and mm-hmm. drought resistant. These are the things they were calling animal fodder and not suitable for for human consumption.
And so, like, can you give me an example of, and so, like, well, why do you think that they were doing this? The same reason they did this to us?
Yeah, same reason. Like, certain, and a lot of African foods, the ones they couldn't completely turn into, you know what I'm saying, not suitable for humans, mm-hmm. they just took all outrightly and attributed to somewhere else.
Right, okay.
Like, eggplants are indigenous to Africa.
Really?
Yes. Sesame seed, or Beni seed, they call it in Senegal, is indigenous. We call it Beni seed in Senegal and in South Carolina. Mm.
Mm.
It's indigenous to Africa.
Wow.
A lot of people don't know that, but it's true. If you want to debate, whatever you want to do about it, there's nothing you can do about it. It's the truth.
Right.
But they ascribe it to being Asian.
How do they do that? Because did Asians get it from Africans and then bring it over there? Or like, did they just making up some shit at this point?
No, that because a lot of the Asian food crops either have African origins or a lot of the Asian food crops that were brought to Africa were domesticated mm-hmm. and refined in Africa.
Mm-hmm.
They left a window open for them to say, oh, this is an Asian crop right. when it really is not.
Right, right.
And they do that for commercial and commerce reasons to make it more palatable for the global market to buy. Mm-hmm. If you say this is African, they we don't want to get it. Say African on it.
Right, right. Yeah, it has that. It has that stigma to the rest of the world that have been right. indoctrinated with white supremacy at this point.
Right. Same thing with shrimp and lobster and crabs, stuff like that. They consider all that to be poor people food.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? They consider it to be something that if you were a civilized person, you didn't eat or even go near.
Mm.
Now you go and get some crabs somewhere, lobster somewhere, you can pay arm and leg
for it. Yeah.
So how the tables have turned.
Right. Right.
You know what I'm saying? We know what's delicious.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? However you want to put it. We know what's the same way. It's culinary is an art.
Mm-hmm.
It's an art form. We mean it caters to your senses.
Yeah, right. Right.
Smell, touch, taste. You see it. You know what I'm saying? So
that kind of makes me all right. So what about this? So, you know, like how like within the Black community, we always, you know, we have our running jokes about a lot of, you know, white people's food being unseasoned. Right. Like where did us seasoning our foods with different spices and all of that kind of thing? Like, where did that come from?
Seasoning, believe it or not, had really nothing to do with taste in the beginning.
Mm.
It had more to do with the preservation of the meat.
Mm-hmm. Right, right.
And it also, as far as the taste wise, it was used to draw out certain aspects and flavors of a certain meat. Mm-hmm. Like when I make lamb,
mm-hmm.
I use mint, thyme, and rosemary, right? Just to give an example.
Mm-hmm.
And those herbs draw out the gamey taste.
Mm.
But it's not gamey anymore.
Right.
Make your lamb taste like chicken.
Right. Right.
I'm serious. It's like lamb. I don't get that aftertaste. I don't get that.
Right.
You gotta know how to do it. You gotta know how to. It's an ancient technique, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, and also too, you know, spices and stuff were part of the trade. People traded for salt. People traded for.
It was valuable at one time, right? Like, yeah. Extremely valuable.
Right. So we have a pepper coast in West Africa.
Right.
Where they was getting the peppers from. Or in Africans say pepe.
Mm.
It's getting the peppers from.
Mm-hmm.
The pepper coast or the rice coast.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? If it's a map to say rice coast on it, there'd be no debate about the origins of our rice.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Pepper coast. So you know there's no debate. I'm not debating anybody on that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You can't touch it. You know, even as negative as may be, if you were an intellectual person and you understand, what is one of the things too, to get unmad at a lot of shit, you got to really understand it.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for sure. You got to understand it to know, I mean, to even, like you were saying before, like a lot of these opinions are uninformed, right? So it's the more you know is whenever you, a lot of times, begin to really become upset and offended.
Yeah. It's a frustration that comes along with being ignorant or something.
Right.
You feel like somebody's pulling the wool over your eye. You always feel like you have a ever-present feeling of being bamboozled. Mm. And it makes you mad. You know what I'm saying? It's an insult to your intelligence.
Right.
And that's a human response to that stimuli. You got to take that human response and not dwell on not knowing, but get informed.
Right.
That's the only way.
Right.
That's the only way. It's the only way is to get informed. You mad about something? I'm frustrated.
Yeah.
you can stew in your juices all you want to.
Right.
But you're going to still be ignorant. Right. And by you stewing in your juices in the meantime, you become rich in the process. You just a rich nigga that's stupid.
Right.
Sorry to use that vernacular.
It's real though.
Pardon my French.
Right.
You still stewing in the juices of being ignorant. You got to get informed. And part of getting informed or being informed is knowing where to get informed at. Because all places, everything that glitter ain't gold.
Yeah. I think that is a lot of the problem too, though. Like the places that these people are going to get informed.
It's easily accessible. The internet makes stuff like that easily accessible.
Yep.
But
you gotta have some discernment.
Right. You gotta have some discernment. You gotta be able to delineate, okay, you know, you gotta know how to qualify and disqualify a source.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. You know what I'm saying? You gotta know how to vet things. You know what I'm saying? I got a whole process that I use every time whether it's a debate or research. My primary purpose of me doing research is to delegitimize my own claims.
Right.
First.
Right.
Like being in a courtroom, the job is to totally disqualify anything that the other side is saying.
Right.
But you got to do it with proof.
Yeah.
Yep. You know what I'm saying? So when I research and do research, even for a debate, I want to be in a position where I can argue the other person's point better than they can.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I take a what-if approach. What if they is right? Let's see it. Let's prove it. And I was debating one Hebrew one time.
Mm-hmm.
And I was pulling out sources and stuff. And after the debate, he texted me like, man, where you get that from? Where you get this from? Where you get that from? And I was showing I was getting it from. This fool took it and made a whole thing out of it. Like, it's proof or something. And I had to go back and debate him again. Like, bro, come on. I thought you were going to do it to learn. And so, you know what I'm saying? To unlearn something. You got more entrenched.
Right. But see, that's another thing too, is what is your intentions with the information?
Right.
You know, but we can keep going though.
But yeah, like I said, I've been a chef for 25 years. My pops is a chef. My uncles were chefs. Going back to slavery times, I had enslaved ancestors who were chefs.
And James Hemings, right?
James Hemings, Sally Hemings' half-brother, would be my uncle.
Wow. And for those who don't know who James Hemings is, can you give us some of that history? And, you know, people may be surprised of the plantation that he came from.
He was enslaved to President Thomas Jefferson.
Yeah.
And he showed an early interest in the culinary arts. Him actually being a Jefferson himself.
Right.
He was the half brother of Thomas Jefferson's wife. And Thomas Jefferson took him to France with him, where he was classically trained. In the culinary world, when they say classically trained, I mean you were trained in some kind of French culinary institute.
Mm-hmm.
So you have an understanding of the French terms like sauté and garbanzé, mm-hmm. and you know, I'm a chef, so I'll be flexing sometimes. I won't go too much into it. Right. The majority of the term, majority when you're in a kitchen setting, no matter where you are, you can be at McDonald's. Majority of the terms for the different utensils, the different mm-hmm. processes is French in origin.
Okay.
But he got classically trained in France to be a chef. And he came back and he worked for Thomas Jefferson as the chef.
And they attribute him to the one kind of like perfecting macaroni and cheese. Yep.
Yeah. Which is a French dish.
Mm-hmm.
But like we know, like I know, it didn't make the sound. Stir bears and get that sound.
Right.
James Hemings did that. He
right.
He hit that wooden spoon and they make that
yeah.
sound.
Yeah.
Y'all know the sound. I ain't got to go.
And I think that's like, you know, that's deep, man. Because of, and also like, the chef that
Hercules
that from George Washington plantation, and you know, reading that, I had read this book on a judge, right? And you know, she was also enslaved by George Washington, but a lot of the book dealt with Hercules as well. And it's just, and you know, like we don't think about it until I guess you know, you come across information that tells you. But they would kind of use these brothers, these chefs who were enslaved to kind of show off in front of like, you know, like their dinner guests and like, you know, like, and their names, these chefs' names would actually begin to, you know, ring some bells and
oh, yeah.
people would want to come and try the food.
Mm-hmm. That's true. A lot of them gained an air of freedom,
right,
from being a chef. You know what I'm saying?
And that's how Hercules dipped off, like he, cause
right,
he
right. They being sent, they would send them to certain, like they were hired out,
right,
to certain places to do other events for other people,
right,
who probably didn't have the money to have an actual chef, but they have enough money to rent one,
right,
or borrow one for occasion or for an event,
right.
That's how catering started. Catering today, that's how it started.
Really?
Catering today started by enslaved Africans going,
oh, wow,
being hired out places to prepare food.
Wow.
The same thing with street vending, or what you would call food trucks today.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That started with enslaved African soup. Enslaved African women, to be exact. And during the slavery times, you can go to Charleston, the Charleston market, or you were in Louisiana, you can go to the markets and you would see African women with selling prepared hot food.
Wow.
Be rice cakes and crab cakes and fritters and hush puppies and all types of stuff.
Wow. Wow.
And that's something they brought from Africa. When the Europeans right. were in Africa and it was in the markets, they it was the first time they saw hot food being sold.
Really?
Ready to eat hot. You take a bite, you got to blow it. You gotta blow it. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. It was amazing. Like, where they get this hot ass food, already made food from?
Wow. And you know, that's see, like I never thought about it like that, but I mean that's big, that's huge, especially think about how we like how food is served now, even all over the world. You know what I'm saying? To think that the origin was with us, it's I mean, obviously. Mainstream won't give us that credit, but whenever we obviously study and we have the proof, you know what I mean? But just to hear it again, you know, like, I mean, it just goes to show, like I said, that's our black genius. You kind of mentioned something before, though, that I wanted to ask you about. And, like, what are your thoughts on the term slave food? And is there such thing? And does it, and if it is, does it exist today?
No, there's no such thing as slave food. In the grand scheme of things, being human, when it comes to fight or flight, or eat or be eat, kill or be killed, swink or swim, food is food. You hungry.
Right.
You hungry. When you hungry, if you from the hood, if you're a real N-word from the hood, right. Nigga, you know how it feels to be hungry.
Right.
And it hurts. That shit hurts. You be hungry. Being hungry hurts.
You get mad.
It's not a thought. It's not for people. You've never been hungry before. You don't understand. It's not a thought in your head like, ooh, I'm hungry. I need to eat something. It's a pain in your stomach. Like, yep. You need to eat or you're going to die.
Right.
That's the difference.
Right. Right.
If you're hungry, everything you say to you, it's nasty. I don't eat. You're going to eat it. It's going to be delicious. Well, so say slave food is an oxymoron.
So what do you think that came from? Because now, you know, especially with that within the conscious community,
who are they conscious of?
Right. But in the so-called conscious community, we hear a lot of, you know, and we hear a lot of slave, you know, the term slave food. And I'm starting to see a more, like, you know, more pushback on that term now, yeah, than I've seen before. But I, you know, and I understand a lot of, like you mentioned before, the ethno-religious groups that were created here, that, you know, being Islamic, outlawed the pig. But that the pig wasn't the only thing that people considered, that at one time the so-called conscious community considered slave food, like chitlins or whatever that came from the pig. They considered other things, what, like you said, scraps or you know, slave food. But now I'm seeing a lot more pushback on that idea that there even is a such thing as slave food.
I hope that the stuff I post and share contributed to that pushback. Because I don't, for a couple of years, I was on everybody's head.
Yeah.
On slave food stuff. I'm like, listen, man, I don't want to go there.
Right.
I'm vegan.
Now, that's okay. A good question. Let's go there. Let's go there real quick. Now, that is a new thing, obviously. Not new. Okay, let me paraphrase. But, let me take that back. That's not a new thing. But we see it growing in popularity. But we're also seeing a narrative attached to it within the community that veganism or vegetarianism is how our ancestors in Africa ate. And that seems to be the most furthest from the truth.
That's totally false.
Right.
Humans in general are going to eat what's readily available to them in their natural environment.
Right.
So if you are an African and you're living in sub-Saharan Africa on a coastal region or by a large body of water, river, stream,
mm-hmm,
you're going to have a higher fish, sea, you know, saying, water-based diet.
Right.
This is more accessible to you.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? If you live in an arid plain and, you know what I'm saying, and certain things are scarce in regards to water, you're not going to really have fish in your diet like that.
Right.
You're going to have more, you know what I'm saying, cattle and other stuff, other things like that in your diet, meat in your diet. I would say our ancestors didn't consume the same portions of meat that we consume today.
Mm, okay.
It was smaller in portion.
Right.
Compared to everything else that we eat.
Do you think we eat too much?
Yeah, we do.
Yeah,
we eat too much meat.
How can somebody tell?
Africans had a high grain and greens diet.
Mm-hmm.
ponyo and couscous and you know what I'm saying, different greens and ligaments. You know, we had a higher, our diet was more of that base.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Fish and fowl, you know, stuff like that.
And so, like, you know, for, and I don't know what people choose to do.
I just want people to know what they, the origins of what they're doing.
Right.
Because if not, you're going to keep running into the same problem.
Right. You know what? It kind of makes me think of this too. I've noticed, and like both sides, in my opinion, are guilty of this. But all of those Netflix documentaries on food seem so biased and with like an agenda, like the ones that are promoting veganism and the ones that are promoting meat consumption. It's like you can tell that money is put into these just to further whatever agenda they're.
And it's always it's Western, any kind of Western entertainment is an agenda attached to it.
Right.
It's a religion. So mm-hmm. the doctrine got to get out some kind of way.
Right, right, right.
You know what I'm saying? You got to get out.
Right.
I was telling people to say vegan. I said, do you know vegan is a dietary restriction that comes from Hinduism?
Mm.
People that practice their own cultural thing that was appropriated, misappropriated.
So do you think, is it possible that in a lot of cases, like, you know, our Rasta brothers in the Caribbean may have peaked that diet, and then our interaction with them over here in the States, would that be one of the reasons that, you know, vegetarianism and veganism got popular within the community?
I wouldn't say that. I think that it's the internet age
yeah.
that made them popular in our community, in the conscious community, grabbing and running with it.
Right.
But the Rastas are more closer to the source than people over here doing it, because you got to remember, a lot of East Indians were yes. in Jamaica.
Right.
So a lot of them could have had an East Indian grandparent that was a Hindu, you know what I'm saying, Hindu, and that's what they practice.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And it kind of converges into the Abrahamic beliefs too. Talk about the Nazarites.
Mm.
They had a restricted diet. And you know, prohibitions around, you know, what you can and can't do to your hair,
mm-hmm.
stuff of that nature. The same thing, like I said, kind of, you know, Abrahamic religions kind of get blurry mm-hmm. when you're in that, because that area is area of confluence.
Right, like
people come in and out through that area over the different apex of time. So
and that's another thing I wanted to ask.
Brahma, Abraham. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know
what I'm saying? That's where I wanted. That's where I kind of wanted to go. This is the last question I want to ask you. We could definitely wrap it up and do a part two or something at another time. But as somebody who is well studied, right? And when we start thinking about like dietary laws that were created by like ancient civilizations around a religion, like, do you have any insights as to like possibly like how they may have come up with some of these things and some of these laws?
It's mainly deity based.
Mm.
Same thing in Africa, like you had to have a session where they, I know my brother Ben can probably go into it better.
Mm-hmm.
My brother Black Panther can go into it better, but when you have your reading from a Babalawo, and they give you an Orisha, they read your Ori, meaning your head, and they tell you, like, based on this Orisha, you can't eat X, Y, and Z.
Right.
You can't do X, Y, and Z. It has no, same thing in the Bible, it has nothing to do whether it's something good or bad for you.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, in the Bible, it says that anything in the cloven hoof and this, you can't eat fat. Listen, that was a priestly thing that they did for the provisions when they make sacrifice. It had nothing to do with diet.
Mm.
Or God or Jesus, however you want to slice it. It was for sacrificial purposes, you couldn't eat fat because the fat was used to burn to create smoke to reach the nostrils of said deity. They had nothing to do with it being bad or good or anything. All the dietary restrictions was around sacrifices.
Right. Right. Wow. That's deep. That's deep. Brother Okomfo, man, I could go on for another hour, man, but I got to get ready for work and stuff in the morning, man. But this was definitely a powerful build, man. And I really appreciate you for, you know, just taking the time and explaining some of these things, man, because I think, especially from the perspective of a historian and a chef, you know what I'm saying? Because I think this is a topic that is often overlooked when it comes to our history and our just ingenuity and our genius. You know what I mean? Like, especially like whenever we got a chance to talk about pre-colonial Africa and even the fact that we had world renowned chefs, and you were even related to one who were in, right. You know what I'm saying? Like that, that's powerful right there. You know what I mean?
It's a big thing. That's a big. A lot of people got their freedom that way.
Right.
A lot of people became millionaires that way. Mm. Early on, a lot of Black African women in America had success, early success in catering.
Oh yeah, they said Hercules dressed better than George Washington.
Oh yeah, Hercules was clean. And he it was slick. It was slick because one of the settler colonial facades they put up is dressing these Africans really well.
Right.
When in fact, they were getting treated less than human. So Hercules took that to his advantage. He was clean on every occasion.
Every occasion.
You know what I'm saying? The stockings on point. Nobody never seen these stockings before. You know what I'm saying? The patty looms and the knickerbockers. And, you know what I'm saying? The petticoat.
And the...
come with it.
Cafeteria in the at the African American History Museum in DC. They got it. I think they have a picture.
Don't say that word around me, man. I still haven't been yet.
Oh man, bro. They got first off, the cafeteria is great, man. Great food. The brothers in there cooking, but they got a picture of Hercules in there. You know what I'm saying? So that's pretty dope.
Yeah, that's dope. But before we close out, I work at a hotel here in Arizona.
Mm-hmm.
It's upscale food.
Right.
And every month we have a chef's dinner with a theme. And, you know, we do certain things. And since I've been there, we added more of an African flavor. We had black eyed peas one time. We had oxtails, okra. No. You know what I'm saying? It's people, you know what I'm saying? Outside of a racist thing and pro everything, it's people having a human experience and eating something they never ate before.
Right.
And being educated on it, you know what I'm saying? Something outside of your own culture, food. And I think it's important that we, you know, whatever we do in life, as a job or whatever, you gotta certify and stamp it with being active. So I'm still new to this place, but by the time Black History Month rolled around, I've been there for almost a year. So I'm planning to do Afro-Atlantic themed.
Oh man.
I'm going to intertwine history and into all the different courses, and we're going to talk about it. And you know what I'm saying? It's going to go down. I want to make it a big thing. So you might get an invite for it.
Oh, man. Let me know. Look, bro, it'd be an honor. It'd be an honor for real. I'm definitely down. Just let me
know. You can say you do your podcast or you stream it, whatever you want to do.
Oh, that's a plan, G. That's the plan. Just let me know, man. Like I said, let me know a little bit in advance, and I'll definitely be there.
Oh yeah,
I'll definitely be there, man. And again, man, I definitely appreciate you for coming on. And you know, this is the first of many, man. You know, you always been somebody, you know, that I felt like extremely intelligent, like mine. We see things sort of the same way, and so you're always welcome, bro. And I definitely appreciate you.
Same, bro. It's mutual.
All right, man. You have a good one, G.
All right. Peace.
Peace.